sinus suffering.
On the left is a decongestant commercial from 2000. On the right, one from 2006. But don't focus on the pressure pads or exploding heads. Look at the boxes. Sudafed and Sudafed PE. PE. Sudafed usually uses pseudoephedrine. Sudafed PE stands for phenylephrine. Today, phenylephrine vastly outsells pseudoephedrine. Yet I'm still congested. I was popping one of these daily, in the morning, every morning, and it just didn't work. But it's not me, and it's not you. That's because
this drug is really not effective.
10 milligrams of phenylephrine works no better than a placebo.
Now there are serious questions about whether it works at all.
Taken from an FDA Zoom meeting, these are the votes of FDA panel members on whether phenylephrine is effective.
Yeah, I voted no.
I voted no.
The data are pretty clear.
How did this happen? It is a story that goes back decades and touches on methamphetamine, COVID, and most importantly, why you were able to buy a decongestant that didn't work. Imagine a grocery store. The FDA regulates food over here and the prescription drugs over here. These are both massive jobs, and a separate FDA job is here, the over-the-counter drugs, OTC, available for anyone to just buy and walk out. And that is what I have been buying. In 1962, the federal government charged the FDA with a new responsibility. Instead of just regulating the sale of drugs, they had to start reviewing the safety and effectiveness of them. They started here, in the prescription section, because they were more worried about it. 10 years later, they got to the OTC drugs. This proposal outlined the plan. But the shelf was big. 100,000 to 500,000 products big, and it was too much to thoroughly work through.
Well, I think people perceive that because something's sold over the counter, it has been reviewed more rigorously, but that is just not true. A lot of the products, the research dates back decades.
That's Joshua Sharfstein. He is a professor, but also a former principal deputy commissioner at the FDA. He helped take over-the-counter cough and cold medicines off the market for kids back in the early 2000s. But in the 70s and 80s, the FDA said that drug ingredients already on the shelf could stay if they were generally recognized as safe and effective by medical professionals. By 1976, they'd convened a looser review and a panel recommended phenylephrine as an oral nasal decongestant. They also recommended phenylpropanolamine and pseudoephedrine. We'll make phenylephrine red because we know it leaves you congested. Like me. Pseudoephedrine blue because it does work, and phenylpropanolamine gray. I'll tell you why later. This list of nasal decongestants, still mostly grandfathered in, was further codified by the 1990s, so you had options on the shelf, sold under many names, and pseudoephedrine became the OTC nose unclogger of choice through the 80s and 90s. And that was kind of the status quo with commercials like these.
You feel well enough to get married, honey?
I do.
Fast-acting Sudafed and long-lasting Sudafed 12-hour.
Take non-drowsy Sudafed at your first
sign. Fight back with Sudafed.
But then this happened.
Pseudoephedrine, a common ingredient in cold medicines like Sudafed, is an essential part of making methamphetamine. In response to that, Congress in 2005 enacts the Combat Methamphetamine Act.
If you need it clearer, imagine Walt and Jesse from Breaking Bad crushing up pseudoephedrine to make meth. This law, tacked onto the Patriot Act, largely meant pseudoephedrine decongestants were put behind the counter. In many states, you could buy it without a prescription, but you had to be ID'd by a pharmacist and were limited in how much you could get.
Pseudo's getting harder and harder to come by.
Phenylpropanolamine was generally considered unsafe by 2000 because it caused some hemorrhagic strokes. Phenylephrine was alone on the shelf. Meth-fighting officials asked companies like Pfizer what took so long, but the FDA's long process meant they couldn't just spin up a new product. Commercials started to look like this.
New Sudafed PE triple action. Also find Sudafed behind the counter.
But even as manufacturers tried to straddle the line, phenylephrine sales, this line, started to beat out this line, pseudoephedrine decongestants, basically because it was alone on the shelf. Now, you probably saw this recent story about the FDA panel recommending against phenylephrine and assumed that they just figured out that it didn't work. That is not the case. They have known for decades that phenylephrine might not really work, and it's just the process that's gotten in the way. Sudafed's replacement No Winner was a 2006 headline, as the key researchers behind that report recalled on the panel this year.
After pseudoephedrine was moved in front of the counter to behind the counter, I received a rash of calls from around the state of Florida asking why oral phenylephrine didn't work.
The take-home messages are oral phenylephrine is ineffective as a nasal decongestant, but safe.
They found that most of the studies ruling it effective came from one lab, Elizabeth Biochemical. The researchers' letter to the FDA from 2006 attracted congressional support from Representative Henry Waxman. It led to further, similarly conclusive studies that phenylephrine was ineffective. So why has it stayed on the shelf for almost two more decades?
We'll hear from Dr. Janet Woodcock, director of the FDA's Center for Drug Evaluation and Research.
Dr. Janet Woodcock shared this list of burdensome, multi-step rulemakings that were typical for new drugs or revisions to old ones.
This process is frozen in 1972 and before, so it doesn't apply to anything later than that. So this is only still trying to deal with those products that were on the market at that time. So there's really nothing for innovation in this entire process.
That matched with significantly smaller funding for the FDA's over-the-counter division versus the prescription drug one. It took until the 2020 CARES Act, a coronavirus relief bill, to make the drugs slightly easier to amend and to give the FDA's over-the-counter division a bit more funding.
The FDA had its hands tied behind its back when thinking about over-the-counter medicines, and now it has more tools and more resources to go about its job.
And in 2023, the advisory panel finally reviewed new studies filled with charts like these, where nasal congestion went down after taking pseudoephedrine and went like this for a placebo and phenylephrine. Now we wait. It is true that all this time I could have gone behind the counter and had pseudoephedrine, been less congested, but I didn't know there was anything wrong with phenylephrine. The advisory panel vote, that spreadsheet, is a recommendation that the FDA still has to act on and implement. And the panelists voting, they seemed a little mystified by how we got to a point where phenylephrine took over.
It's amazing the amount of dollars being spent on something that has really no efficacy.
I went through pharmacy school and medical school, and I have taken courses on over-the-counter medications, and I had no idea until prepping for this how limited the data was.
Well, the drug companies have made billions of dollars off of this medication, you know, for all these years.
You know, people really don't like change. And this is going to change, you know, how the cold and cough aisle looks in the, you know, in the pharmacy. That does not suggest in any way that they should not stay the course.
I am miraculously healed. Okay. My name is Phil Edwards. I'm the producer of this episode. I'm doing culture coverage. You've seen the awesome looking slate at the beginning. We're defining culture really broadly. We're going to be talking about all sorts of different things that kind of affect the way that we live. I have one quick request for you before we go. Here at Vox, you know, our mission is to have our journalism be free to everybody. We don't want to put it behind the counter. That's a little callback to the video for you. We don't want to have a paywall. We don't want to do it. It's just not a value that the company has and that we have. As part of a larger company, sometimes our work is supported by advertising, but it's not enough. We need a little extra push to get us over the hump. And so that's why we're looking to you. If you can help keep our journalism free and support our more ambitious work, go to vox.com/give now to make a contribution. Your contributions support all our coverage across Vox. And as a thank you to those of you who make recurring contributions, we will give you access to newsletters, behind-the-scenes Q&As with journalists from across the whole Vox newsroom. All right. Thanks for watching.